South by Southwest has ended, and the sun has returned to the capital city. The 16th-ranked Texas Longhorns seek their first Big 12 sweep in nearly a year. On the other side, the Kansas State Wildcats just hope to salvage a win from their trip to Austin. It's the Wildcats and the Horns, and it's next on Longhorn Network. Well, thank you, Mother Nature. We have baseball weather, finally, for the series finale between Kansas State and 16th-ranked Texas here at UFCU Dish Falk Field. Yeah, some clouds in the sky, but we can see blue, and there is no rain. Kevin Dunn here with my two All-Americans, one just threw out the first pitch. We're going to get to that, Greg Swindell and Keith Moreland. But, Greg, let's go ahead and start with the guy who's going to be pitching on that mound for Texas. That's Casey Clemens. Rough first start against Rice. What have you seen since then?
Well, he's getting comfortable on the mound. He's getting reps. He's getting in there. He had a good outing Tuesday against UTA up in Arlington. His last 17 starts, you see there, I mean, innings, a 2.12. So continue to develop. He's getting a feel for the breaking ball, and his changeup is really coming along real well.
He's going to be facing a Kansas State lineup, Keith, that, well, let's just be honest, they're struggling right now.
Well, they're struggling, and they're struggling in so many different departments. They're less than 550 when you OPS as a team. They haven't slugged the ball. They have two extra base hits in the entire series, and you're not going to win a lot of ball games when that happens. They're struggling to get guys on base. Up and down the lineup, they have got to swing the bat. They don't have a dominant pitching staff, even though their pitching staff's pitched quite well in this series and has all year long. Where they've struggled is to be able to put enough runs on the board. Coming into this series, averaging 5 runs a game. Hasn't been that way in this series so far.
Texas pitching has gotten the best of them. We're going to give you these starting lineups and the starting pitchers as Kansas State and Texas look to close this thing out. Longhorns looking for the sweep. We're going to play some baseball when we get back.
Texas Baseball on Longhorn Network is brought to you by American Campus Communities, where students love living. Reserve your housing online today at livewc.com.
Great shot. You see the clouds. They've been moving, and luckily moving pretty much away from Central Texas, at least the rain has. We take a look at Kansas State. Brad Hill, his 12th season. 4 NCAA appearances in the last 6 seasons. They are 11-11, looking for their first Big 12 win this season. Let's take a look at their lineup. As Keith mentioned, they are looking for more production. One guy who has stood out is Shane Conlon.
Well, Shane Conlon is the one guy that can play on any team in the conference. He is an outstanding player in this series. He has one of the extra base hits. They only have 2. He's driven in a run. He's a guy that can steal a base if you need to steal a base. Doesn't have big-time power, slaps the ball all over the field. He's the guy that's going to have to get something going for them. And you can see Alex B. also in the lineup today. They're searching right now, Greg, for some kind of offense as they face Casey Clemens today.
They're going to have to attack Casey Clemens. He's going to be around the plate. He's still, like I said, he's still getting out there. Texas is looking for that Sunday starter. They've had Josh Sawyer. Connor Mays has started out on Sundays. But Casey Clemens right here can put himself on the map to be one of those starters for Texas as the rest of the conference series.
5.40 ERA, but as we're going to show you, has been much better in his last 4 starts. Carter Yagi is going to lead it off. And we're underway with game number 3. Good to see a low strike called.
Well, Kelly Nutt has a bigger strike zone. That's one thing we've known him for a long time. He's been a good umpire for a long time. He usually has a pretty good size zone. It'll stay that way all day.
Yagi hitting 250 this series. 2-for-8. Change up in there for a strike.
Yeah, there you see the floater right there. Good arm speed, good. It looked like his fastball right there, and it just comes out of his hand a lot slower.
Hitting is rhythm and timing. You've heard us say that many times, and if you can disrupt that with changing speeds, you really don't need a breaking ball. It's nice to have a good breaking ball, but a good change is always good as well.
3-2.
See right there, Casey really slowed up on that one. Tried to make it slower instead of just trusting his grip and trusting his delivery.
upstairs, and Yagi's aboard.
Well, if there's one number, when you look at Casey's numbers, to me, Greg, that jumps off the page, that's his 11th walk to go against just 10 strikeouts. He is not a guy that can blow you away. So the one thing he can't do, he's got to pitch to contact a little more.
Yeah, not put the extra runners on you. He's had two walks in each of his outings this year. He needs to cut down on that. You look at it and say, well, two, that's not that many. Well, it is when you're not striking people out and you're having to pitch to contact. That means they're putting the ball in play a lot more without the extra runners on base. Just can't afford to do that.
There's Clayton Dalrymple. It's 0 for 6. Came in red hot. Came in hitting 373. Get the bunt down. That was at first, but they're going to call a foul ball.
I believe it bounced up.
It didn't look like it did, but
hit him in the thigh. But good job by Michael Cantu to continue to go out and get that ball and throw him out at first.
Well, it hits him while he's in the box, Greg. If you're in the box, it's a foul ball. You see him. He's definitely in the batter's box. It does touch off the left knee. Now, if he had taken a step out of the box and his both feet were out of the box, he's out if the ball's in fair territory.
Clayton's junior from Coppell. Gets it down. Clemens going to try to go to second. Gets the lead out. Safe at first. Runned that one a little bit too hard.
Texas obviously expecting the bunt right there, and Casey Clemens did a real good job of getting off this mound. See the bunt right out in front of him. He got to it quickly, then he was able to turn and get the out at second base. Dalrymple kind of slowed up. CJ almost got him at first base.
Yep. Here's Conlon. Shane, really one of the only offensive guys on this team. It was a part of that 2013 Super Regional team. It's safe to say the best team in Kansas State history. That's what he's done this year after kind of having a down junior year a year ago. And Brad Hill said, yeah, there's no doubt that the draft was in his mind.
Well, that happens to a lot of players, Kevin. I mean, you get yourself in a position and then, you know, that sort of goes away and say, go back. You say, I'm going to go back, finish my degree. I mean, we forget so many times to talk about these guys are student athletes.
Mm-hmm.
And they do stay 3 years. I mean, it's different than basketball, which is only 1 year. They have to be on campus 3 years. You're three quarters of the way to your degree when you leave. Should be, anyway.
Runner takes off, and Dalrymple will take second.
Thought we would see a little more of that, Greg, in this series.
Yeah.
Didn't you feel like that's what Brad Hill sort of told us when we talked to him a little bit yesterday? He says, we're going to have to do some things to try to create some runs. We're not an outstanding offensive team. We've got to do the little things, run, hit and run, bunt, try to get ourselves in position to score.
And especially now. I mean, they've played two games. They haven't scored a lot of runs. They're going to press the issue against KC.
This has hit a ton, but foul.
There's one thing. Texas pitching has done well this series. The two games yesterday is holding, mixing times when runners are on base.
Texas took the doubleheader yesterday, looking for the three-game sweep here today. Changes the eye level with the fastball there. What do you come with, guys?
His changeup is good, but if I'm a lefty hitter, right, it's a dangerous pitch. If they're looking for it to a left-hander, he just pulled one down the line. I like the heater.
Fouls it back. Conlon's a senior from Naperville, Illinois. Kansas State does a good job of recruiting Illinois, Ohio.
Okay.
Dalrymple runs pretty well at second. Kansas State with their best hitter up. Lifted in the air, Shaw's underneath it. Makes the play, and there's two outs. That's a big one to get for Casey Clemons.
Anytime you get a hitter like Shane Conlon to pop up like that with a runner in scoring position, you're doing a good job. But right now, he needs to focus on Steve Cerutori right here. That third out's the most important. You don't want to give Kansas State any momentum early in this ballgame.
Sophomore from Austin, Minnesota, comes in hitting 293. It's a pretty good-looking hitter there, and he takes strike one. Sprayed down the left field line. Cases ahead in the count here, 0-2. A lot of options here.
A lot of options. I think you can go away. Casey's got pretty good run on that fastball. A good fastball outside the zone away. Or possibly could bust him in right here too and then go back to the changeup. Try to get him to chase up.
The third, and Dalrymple's out. You got to be careful with Michael Cantu, the freshman, and showing his arm all year long. Texas coming to bat. Welcome back. Texas coming to bat here in the first inning. Their head coach is Augie Garrido. He has more wins than anyone else in college baseball. 1,934. Texas now 4-1 in the Big 12. Been pretty good here at the dish and looking for their first series sweep against Kansas State since 2011. Let's take a look at his lineup, and a guy who's really been hot, and Augie wanted him to get hot, and we've seen it, Keith, is Brooks Marlowe.
Well, he leads the team in hitting and conference play. He's got a 10-game hitting streak. Not only has he driven the ball, he's moved into a different role. In the leadoff spot last year, this time he's in an RBI situation, a run production role, and he's really done a nice job. He's developed into that role. You can tell he's a lot more comfortable. And today they're going to have to go out, this Texas lineup, and face a guy that's a good sinker baller.
Good sinker baller. Corey Fisher making his first Big 12 start. We saw Colton Kalmus yesterday making his first Big 12 start. A sinker slider pitcher so far this year. 37 ground balls and only 9 flyouts.
Ben Johnson will lead it off for Texas. Swinging at the first pitch. Cerutori throws him out. One pitch, one out. And here is Fisher and what he's done. 4.63 earned run average. 17 strikeouts to 11 walks.
38 base runners there, Greg. That's a lot for a guy that's not going to be overpowering. So yeah, that's one of the things he's trying to cut down on is the number of base runners he's allowing per inning.
And his last three starts has a 7 ERA. So allowing extra base runners does hurt.
It's Colin Chaw. Colin at 293 does have those 13 doubles. Good for second in the country. To second. Yeah, he's up with it, and good start here for Fisher.
Well, recorded two outs, Greg, just as you said, both on the ground.
We get a lot of those sinker slider pitchers. They keep the ball down in the zone. Not afraid to throw the sliders to lefties.
Can tell already he likes to work quickly. He's on the mound ready to go for CJ's in the box.
And I think Kansas State's also looking for that extra energy.
Yep.
Get something going. Saw that with Dalrymple getting thrown out at third to end the top of the first.
There's CJ Hinojosa. This is laced. Watch out down there. Seems to be getting a lot more of the barrel on it, Keith.
Yeah, he and Marlowe both are the guys that, along with Boswell, that I've said, got to get going. Got to get them going offensively. And And CJ's getting closer. There's no question about it. He's staying in it. You can see his confidence is a lot better. He's swinging at more strikes. That's the other thing that's happened to him. When he starts to struggle, he swings at a lot of pitches outside of the zone, especially up.
You see a lot of ground balls. That thing is sinking.
Tommy Nick still got it down there.
Oh, of course. Not long ago, he was what now?
Good way to lose a fingernail, though.
You're right. That's why Ryan Russ doesn't touch him.
Russ could probably take a few notes right there.
One, two. It's outside. CJ spoils that. CJ is hitting 231 against right-handers this year. Actually struggled more against left-handers, only 3 for 19. Counts full. Eighth pitch of the at-bat coming. This is ripped to right. First hit of the game.
What a great at bat, Keith.
Huh? Well, he does. He gets deep into the count, and the other part that's good, he seemed to go with the fastball away, doesn't try to pull it. Front shoulder stays in there a lot longer when he's going well. And we talked about it. He gets a lot of balls that he hits on the barrel of the bat the other way. Yes, he has the ability to pull and hit the ball in the ballpark. But it's a big field, and you got to use both sides of it.
Tres Barrera, big cut. Well, Hinojosa is hitting 407 with two outs this year. Tres is second on the club with a 321 average. Saw CJ take off yesterday. We'll see if he tries to get in scoring position. To left. Going back. It's off the wall. They're going to send home CJ. Here comes the relay. The throw, not in time. It's 1-0 Texas.
Great job by Tres Barrera right there. After seeing one pitch, gets this one right here, right on the inner half of the plate. Looks like he's trying to make it 2-0 right there, but very aggressive by Tommy Nicholson too down there in the third base coach's box. This ball down in the corner. He can read the throw. It's a good relay. CJ just hustles home. Had to be a perfect throw to get him. Horn's able to jump on top with two outs.
Also did a good job on the left to get that in as quickly as possible. Here's Marlowe. That's the second first inning RBI double for Tress this series. As Brooks looks to extend his hit streak to 11.
Texas has been really good when they scored first, guys.
Yep. Stopped by Tyler Moore. Well, Texas is 10-3 when scoring first this season.
Those are good numbers.
That'll work.
Yes, sir.
More can't stop this one, and Barrera will move up to third. I'm guessing that's going to be a wild pitch.
Pace is slowed, too. Start to get in some trouble, give up a base hit, an extra base hit. All of a sudden, pace of the pitcher, pace of the game starts to slow down. It always felt like that's a real advantage to the offensive team.
He got two quick outs.
Yep.
Got two quick outs and then gave up a couple rockets, one to right center, one down the left field line. Now you start to think a little bit. You start to try to be too fine.
Nice pitch, 2-2. It just fell off.
Nice slider by Fisher.
To third. Cerutori stays down on it, makes the throw. And Texas strands a runner at third, but they hit the ball pretty well. CJ Hinojosa got it started, and Tres Barrera brings him home. We played one, it's the horns by one.
One nothing Texas as we go to the second. Early, our partner here, Kevin, did a really nice job. You could see right here, we're trying to make sure he knew he threw in this direction, which he did that very well. The second thing is, we'll erase that. And the second thing is, we went to, you had to be inside the box to be good. So he did that. So let's go forward now and see if he knew where to throw with it and if he could get it inside the box.
Oh.
That is just unbelievable, partner. Well done. You look like George Bush. Ooh. Doing it. The president of the United States. And then right here, the great part about it, look at the little horns.
You
on
were
the way
nervous.
Out. Nice going, Greg.
That's just a big sigh of relief right there. You get out, you're expected to get the ball over the plate, and I've thrown out four or five first pitches, and I get nervous. I was shaking when I got up here to the booth.
Well, I just wanted to make sure you knew what direction to throw it. If you remembered that.
It's been a while.
Yeah.
Did you have to loosen up the arm today?
That was my first throw of the day right there.
It really? Did not register on our bug
it
gun,
didn't.
So we didn't go for that. But you were right in the middle of the box.
You practice what you preach, right? I mean, we talk about first pitch strikes.
Yeah, you were right there,
buddy. Start of the game was,
it was
strike one.
That's it. Well done.
1-1 to Steve Cerutori. It's underneath this. Ben Johnson doesn't have to move very much, and there's one out.
I will tell you one thing. I'm glad the sun's out because it was blinding coming off those legs out there.
You just look at that, 43-8 with a 1.92. Not bad.
Not bad at all. 501 strikeouts, UT record, 14 shutouts. And like Zonk, a three-time first-team All-American as Krause gets out of the way. He threw a little bit harder here at Texas, but...
Yeah, that looked more like an Epus right there.
No, he was right there. I thought I mean, when I drew the box, when I first saw it, I was amazed you were inside the box.
Marlowe backing up. Now he's going to give way to Colin Shaw.
We had a little side bet with the guys
in the
truck. And everybody in the truck said you'd bounce it. Hey, you got to tell you, your partner said he'll get it right there. He'll get it there in the
air.
I
did.
See, there's just no faith coming out of that truck. Obviously, they didn't see me pitch in my career.
Yeah, well, you did it for 17 years. I'm being real surprised.
You got to remember that Brad, our director, is a big Astros fan, so he's worried about
that. I obviously threw a lot of strikes there because I gave up a lot of hits and a lot of home runs. Right?
It's got to be over the plate to go far, doesn't it?
Right.
Here's Alex B. He's from Normal, Illinois. I know Illinois pretty well, my dad being from Chicago. Where's Normal?
Normal, Illinois State University.
Okay.
Right.
Coach Hill just looking for some offense. His changeup is low, and B is in there. I mean, you really just got to look for any option, and he told us that. Since they are trying to find their identity, like Texas is in certain parts of their team.
Well, with the weather, and then they travel down on their spring break. Get to it after this pitch. I thought the interesting thing, he says, you know, we tried to get out of Manhattan and go get some weather and get to do. We got one workout in the state of Texas this week.
Yeah.
Because it rained everywhere.
And it was 73 in Manhattan, apparently.
Yes, and beautiful.
Two tried to frame it and counts full.
Casey's not missing by much.
No, he's not.
Three balls to be right here. They've all been around the zone.
It's upstairs.
Nothing more irritating, though. Not to, Greg, I'm going to refer to you here, but as a catcher, I go back to trying to lead a game and doing whatever. You get two quick outs, and you get two strikes on a guy, and you miss three times. As a catcher, it's frustrating to me. I can't get you to get him to put it in play.
It is. I mean, because you're thinking one pitch away, and I'm out of this, and you just lose concentration just slightly. But pitches were close. He made some good pitches.
Second walk for Casey. As Tyler Moore steps to the plate and takes a first pitch strike. Has enjoyed Manhattan a lot more than hitting on the road. One and one.
Well, they really have struggled away from Manhattan offensively as a team, not just Tyler.
B is one for one stealing bags this year. A little surprised Dalrymple made that third out to end the first at third. I mean, obviously, they don't have much of a scouting report on Cantu because he's been gunning people out all year.
Taking a chance is what Kansas State has to do. Do they try to force the issue? I mean, it was a perfect throw. Brett Boswell was a little late getting there, but the throw was right where it should have been, just on the inside part of the bag, and all at once, Brett caught it and applied the tag.
One and two. Once again, a strike away from getting out of this inning. After two quick flyouts.
Needs to get a feel for that breaking ball as well. Tried it earlier in this at bat. Right now might be a good time to try it again.
Greg, I was thinking right along with you. Fastball changeup, you can pitch with that and be effective because it disrupts timing. But what you need to add as a starter, and you're going to face 20, 27, 28 batters in a game, need another pitch. You know, if you're going to come in and face five batters in a relief appearance or seven batters, you can get away with two pitches.
Mm-hmm.
But as you get deeper, you need that third pitch.
At least three as a starter.
Yes.
When I started, I had four. When I went to the pen, I used a fastball slider to lefties and fastball changeup to righties. There's the breaking ball right there. Just missed. Wouldn't be surprised if he tried it again.
That's the best one he's thrown. Got on top of that one, yeah.
Not much of a lead for B. Takes off. Throw down. Got him. Another seed from the freshman from Moody.
That's from his knees, Kevin. Never came up. Fell down on his left knee, folks. Can't be done any better than that right there.
Texas leads 1-0. Michael Cantu has gunned out two guys, and throughout the whole break, we were just sitting here talking about Cantu. And Keith, you mentioned Benito Santiago, a guy you played with.
Well, I played with a guy that had a tremendous arm, and it's such a weapon to take away the running game. You can see him coming right down to his knees, and the only way he gets him out, 1-2 is a great delivery to the plate, or 1-3. It gives your catcher a chance. But Michael Cantu can throw guys out when you're 1-6. because he gets it to second base in 1-6. It's just an incredible. He is as good as I've seen at this level ever at throwing.
Wow. And he's ended two innings now, the first two innings, without Casey having to throw another pitch. And that's
ever.
Huge.
I mean, it's spectacular to watch.
Oh, and by the way, he can hit. I think scouts may like that, but scouts got to keep their hands off of him for 3 years.
Now he can come up, and you and I both, Greg, to finish that, he can come up on a ball up and away and do the normal stand, inside step throw as a catcher normally does. But what's incredible to me is his ability to lay down on that left knee and deliver the ball 3 feet off the ground, 127 feet, 6 inches strong.
Boswell gets this into the outfield for a base hit. Diving effort from Wolf, but he couldn't get it. Boswell looks like he may be starting to heat up a little bit.
Says inside this ball, really nice adjustment he's made. You know, talked about having really being soft on that front side. He's getting that front side down softly. The head's not bouncing. He's a lot more fluid through the ball.
Been on base a bunch this series, and here is Cantu. Fisher taking a long time. Delivers a strike. Well, Cantu hit 352 for his career at Moody, one of the baseball powers in Texas, had 14 home runs. But the thing that Augie always told me, he said he had 109 ribbies. He wasn't getting pitched to a lot. This guy can produce. Also lettered 4 years as a quarterback on the football team.
Oh, yeah, he never missed a day of school either.
Never missed a day of school from
kindergarten.
K through 12, ranked 7th in his senior class, National Honor Society. And if you're wondering, yeah, he's a really good guy.
Very good kid.
You guys have daughters.
I had to skip senior day, didn't you? Didn't everybody have to skip senior day?
Didn't you get sick? I mean, something.
Okay, I skipped half of my senior year. Okay.
There was one.
Stopped by Moore. He's been pretty good behind the plate as well, as we brag on Cantu.
Maybe my kids just lied to me and said, Dad, everybody takes senior day off.
No, they okay. Were right. I went to the same high school as your kid, so.
Not Michael Cantu.
Cantu has proven to be comfortable hitting with two strikes. Boswell with a pretty good lead. Bounce even.
Well, that's a good time. This is when I put people in motion. Coach Grito hasn't done a lot of that because most of the guys are on their own, Greg. In this scenario, but sometimes I to get things happening, sometimes I'd put the steel on and say, we'd like to get some motion right here.
It's a slider pitch count right now, too.
Yes.
Not going. Count will run full here.
Let's elaborate a little bit right there, Greg. You and I both see it's a slider pitch count. More, how many sliders are down? Is that one in the dirt? You automatically got the bag.
Yeah.
Those are some of the things, the reason there's certain counts. When I say or Greg says it, it's a good count to run because you know that particular pitch is more than likely coming, and that pitch is more likely to be in the dirt.
The odds are in your favor.
Yes, they are.
Ooh, T-Nick. Now, that one he may want to watch out with. Zonk, that was a little hard.
That had that
second, I'm out of the way.
That had that second top spin you talk about.
Yeah. Fingernail gone.
There,
just leave it alone. Lots of fans here would like a baseball.
Wonder who's more stoic, Brett Boswell or Tommy Nicholson. 3-2 coming up. Boswell will take off, and it's ball four. Well, guys, you get the sense here that with Texas going for the sweep and Kansas State really struggling offensively, this is a big moment for both teams.
Well, this is an opportunity to separate yourself in the game and maybe step on the gas a little bit here early in the game. And I think Brad Hill understands that too. He said, hey, we're still right in the ball game. You know, we've got to make a play right here. Do you put the bunt on here? That's an interesting tip. Last year, the last 5 years, there would be no doubt about it.
I say yes. Casey Clemens up right now. He's your pitcher. Do you want him on bay? Do you want him running? Did swing the bat good yesterday, but I would think right here you might put the bunt on Casey being the pitcher designated hitter today.
That makes sense as he is DHing. Pulling a little Brooks Kieschnick. But that way, one pitch, you're back in there. Don't waste any energy.
Helping yourself out.
Yep.
These guys are having a tough time getting on the same page. The pace of this game, where he started out real quickly, was working quickly, and that's his MO. Everybody said, hey, he works quickly. Right now, he has really slowed down.
Mm-hmm.
He understands that he can't afford the way his team, or lack of, they score on the road. If he gives up two or three runs, it could be over.
Bottom of the second inning here, no outs. Boswell at second. Cantu at first, Casey Clemens at the plate.
I'm expecting to bunt on the corners.
And they get it, and that is a nice one. Moore's only play is at first, and Casey helping himself out.
Great execution there, making sure get the bat out in front, get the ball down, really deaden the ball. Moore does a nice job of bouncing out there. Now Zane Gerwitz needs to get it done. Infield at halfway, unusual. That tells you something else about the offense for Kansas State, that early in the game you'd have the infield up.
You wouldn't normally squeeze in this situation with the corners up.
To first, and Zane is going to take the out, not the at bat Zane wanted right there.
Forcing the issue right now as a hitter. You just get overly excited and forcing the issue instead of staying calm, seeing the ball, and having a game plan, Greg, when you walk to the plate. You know, you come to the plate here, he was swinging. You can just almost see, I'm swinging at this first one. This ball's down and away. The only one place you can hit it's on the ground. So you're looking for a ball up that you know you can get in the air in the center of the diamond.
There's Ben Johnson. You saw Conlon motion to the infielders. This guy can run, don't forget.
See if Fisher can feed off of Ben Johnson's aggressiveness, keep the ball out of the zone. Good slider down right there.
This is best pitch of the day.
Yeah, that ball was good bite in the middle of the plate, but nonetheless, down with a good bite on a good slider.
Oh and two.
Ben, well, Ben yesterday was outstanding, especially in the second ball game. Comes up, makes a good throw to the plate right here. In a 1-1 game, this is a chance for K-State to take the lead. Throws the runner out the plate. Comes back in game two. Doubles and triples. Drive in a run and score a run. He's been outstanding for the junior from right here in Austin, Texas.
He was 2 for 4. The other two outs were
lasers.
Yeah, they were. To short. Ranging over and making the play is Wolf. Texas gets a couple in scoring position, but Torrey Fisher works out of it. It's Texas by one.
We're back. We're going to look around the country in college baseball. Some big happenings out there in Oregon State. Drew Rasmussen, a perfect game, first one in Oregon State history, 103 pitches.
Yeah, I think when you told me that, I had not read that, but that, think about that. That's 9 innings of baseball for 103 pitches in a perfect game. Most of the time, that's in the 125 category. A lot of time, 118. A&M obviously suffers their first loss of the year as they lose the finale at A&M, too shy of the best start in school history, but still 24-1. You're at the halfway point, and you've only got one loss. That's a team that's going to have to be reckoned with in the Southeast Conference, and then Ole Miss, I believe that travels to Florida and wins two out of three in Florida.
That's a big win for Ole Miss. And yeah, A&M, you look at their strength of schedule. Last I saw, 247 around there. Texas at 6. I don't care who you're playing. You go 24-1. May not be the 89 club, but that's pretty impressive. Tyler Moore with Kansas State's first hit. Moore was up at the plate when B got thrown out in the second.
You know, we will start as we continue throughout the rest of the year, guys. We'll start to get, because I know all three of us are paying attention to what's going on across the country, and you're starting to get a real sense of the strength of each league. I mean, the Pac-12, to me, is a lot better than people are giving credit to at this point. I think you'll start to see that goes. Of course, the Southeast Conference is always one of the elite baseball conferences in the country.
ACC seems a little down, considering the North Carolinas of the world, and obviously Georgia
right.
Tech's been down for
and
a little
Florida
while.
And Florida State is probably not at the same level that they've been in the last few years. Of course, Virginia is still a very good program.
Yep. Here's Max Brown. He's hitting 260 on the year. We mentioned yesterday that Friday night, 6 of the top 10 teams lost. Seems to be a lot of parity, and as Keith says, we're kind of figuring out who's who. As we take a look at the USA Today coaches poll, TCU followed by LSU. There are the Gators at 3, Texas A&M at 4. Vanderbilt, they are loaded as Casey will go to first. The sacrifice is good.
But now you're starting to get into where the competition is going to step up because you're in conference play across the country. I mean, I know you said you watched a little bit of Arkansas and LSU. I saw a little South Carolina, Missouri. So you're watching some of the teams around the country. But some of the just really feel like that the Pac-12, to me, is probably one of the conferences that it's not getting as much love. And I think there's 5 or 6 teams, including USC.
USC
is a good ball club.
They are. We had Dustin McComas from D1 Baseball on, and that was one of the teams he mentioned. Clemens has first pitch strikes to 9 of 11 batters as Wolf steps to the plate.
Casey works his into the third inning. Texas has Travis Duke warming up down in their bullpen.
I would think.
Getting hot.
Yeah. That was a different sign in the Texas bullpen.
I think with Casey, to be honest, I think they would try to get 4 out of him. I don't think they were going to go extremely deep with him. That was just my gut feeling that they were going to try to start matching up probably in the 4th or 5th inning.
If you're wondering how 9 of 11, don't forget Michael Cantu altered a couple at-bats. There's the rocket.
Casey's father. I like that.
There's a lot of stuff we could put on there. 7-time Cy Young, 1983 national champ.
Fill up the screen.
All right. Marlowe was breaking towards the bag, and it's 3-2. Second base was wide open there, guys.
It sure was. And then that's what right there you see Brooks Marlowe, a senior, yelling in and saying, hey, look, you gotta either step off in that scenario or allow me to get back to my position before you deliver the baseball.
4-3 ball count. Fouled out of play.
best thing you can do in that scenario is just step off.
Yes, sir. A lot of pitches in the upper part of the zone, mm-hmm. but he's had just enough on it that they haven't been able to get on top of it.
Casey went 8-0 with a .27 ERA on the mound as a senior at Memorial High School in Houston. Two pitch coming to Tyler Wolf, junior from Maple Plain, Minnesota.
With Yagi on deck, possibly Casey's last hitter.
Just misses low, and runners on first and second now, and that will turn the lineup over.
Boy, just missed right there. This is just down. It is down.
Mm-hmm.
But that's where you want to miss. If you're going to miss, you want to miss there.
Here's Carter Yagi. Carter walked to lead the game off. And here he is missing up again.
Yeah, Skip's going to come out.
Texas has been great defensively getting pitchers out of jams with double plays. Yesterday, they were able to do the same thing.
Well, yeah, you see up the middle right here. They've been one of the best combos in the nation the last couple years. C.J. Hinojosa and Brooks Marlow, and this one here is tailor-made for C.J. Quick step on the bag, gets it to first, but this one right here, tough play for Boswell, but he's got that nice, quick wrist throw that he does at second base right there. Quick delivery, gets it to Brooks at second base. But his team has pulled pitching staff out of a lot of holes. A pitcher's best friend right there, the double play.
And seven for Texas. Well, he doesn't have the arm, and he's not the vacuum that David Morrell was defensively. But Morrell transferred so quickly, and you can see some of that with Boswell at third. Once again, I'm not comparing him defensively to David Morrell. That wouldn't be fair to any college third baseman. 1-1.
Fastball after a visit to the mound. I know we keep talking about that, but it's so true. I always watch that.
Shaded over. Change up, nice one, 1-2.
Best pitch of the inning. Good motion with it right here, Greg.
A lot of times you'll see Casey, he slows up sometimes and tries to let his motion take the speed off the ball instead of trusting his delivery, trusting his grip. That one right there looked just like his fastball.
Over through that, 2-2.
Well, I come back with the change right here, but you're right, Greg. It's a hitter. If I see the pitcher slow down, I know change. I just slow my motion down. But if you can have your arm speed of a fastball, that's when the changeup's the most effective.
Right field. Shaw dealing with the wind, which is blowing it to right. They will tag to third. As sliding in is Tyler Moore. Wolf stays at first, so two outs here. Well, guys, Casey said even, he said, you know, when I realized how valuable the changeup can be, when I was hitting last year and struggling. He said, you know, when you change speeds like that, you realize it as a hitter just how tough it is.
Come on, bud.
Here's Clayton Dalrymple.
We're in a spot right here with Dalrymple, maybe not, but you could see maybe a little first and third, try to steal a run. I mean, Kansas State's struggling to put runs across, and maybe might use any tactic right here.
Clayton's due.
In case he does not retire him, I think his day is over. Just watching what's going on in the bullpen.
Travis Duke has been getting loose. We've not seen much of Duke.
Boy.
2-0. When you're missing up, Greg, what does that indicate?
Just flying. I mean, front shoulders flying open. You're not getting good balance, not getting your arm through. I mean, once you get out in front, so you drift slightly towards the plate, your arm has to speed up. Everything is thrown off at that point.
2-1.
When you say not getting through, it's like it's dragging.
Oh, exactly.
Yeah, the arm's dragging.
It's dragging because it gets out of your glove late, so it tries to speed up to catch up with the rest of your body, and it's just too late.
To right, coming in is Shaw, and this is going to drop. Kansas State is on the board, and we're tied.
Does a nice job. This ball's again up, fights it off, inside out swing. Nothing fancy, just able to get his hands inside, get the barrel on the ball, and has enough on it to get it out of the infield onto the outfield grass. It's the first time we've seen Kansas State being able to continue inning, just scrape through an inning and find a way to get a two out knock.
Good opportunity for the Wildcats with Conlon up, who takes the first pitch strike. Got one in the first. Kansas State answering this inning. Going two.
Very good fastball by Casey. Went away with the first one. Trusted enough to come back inside with the second one.
This will be his 23rd pitch of the inning. One, two.
He's got to trust the grip right here.
Think he can change up?
Think he can change up.
Not go.
This is close. A chance to see it from the side. Ooh. I think he swung.
I think he did too. It's Bill McGuire at third, and Keith.
That's a swing.
Let's explain the difference of what you're actually looking for.
It's not a break of a wrist. In my opinion, it's the hardest call there is for an umpire, but it did the intent of the barrel of the bat. It's intent. I know that's a unique word, but I think it's the barrel of the bat crossing the plate in a pattern. Even though you're stopping, the wrist didn't break. When that barrel gets across the plate, in any capacity to me, you swung.
Mm-hmm. Big pitch coming up here in the third inning. To left, and Johnson underneath it, and Texas able to get out of it, but the Wildcats do get on the board and are able to tie this thing up. Kid from Coppell finally able to break through back in his home state. finally, a nice day here in Austin, Texas. Maybe God was telling us something, guys, as the weather gets nice as South by Southwest ends. Not sure how that all connects, but South by is over with officially today. So Austin getting back to normal, or as normal as it's ever been.
Keep Austin weird.
Keep it weird.
Great Dawson Swindell.
Mr. Dawson.
Waving up here.
Now he was wearing, he's wearing 21.
We got a 21 t-shirt on, representing today.
Representing Pops. Throughout the first pitch. We're tied here at one. As Colin Shaw will lead it off. 2, 3, and 4 due up for the Horns. To left. So that barbecue smoke.
You were going to talk about that one.
Well, just, you know.
You'd have a tough time playing left today.
Oh, I would. I'd be looking at that the whole time.
Just an aroma.
Well, I like that they have that now that they've moved the dugout, that it actually catches the visitors before it catches the home team.
Think it might make you lazy?
Yeah. I can smell it up here.
You could have a gluten-free power bar.
Yeah.
Our partner just had one.
That looks really appetizing. There's CJ, who singled and scored back in the first.
I'm living on throat lozenges.
Got everything up here in the booth.
It's a nice job by Casey getting out of that inning, guys. But you got to turn back here offensively and start getting something going again offensively. Had a great opportunity in the second. It was second and third and one out and came away empty.
For a strike, 2-1.
I really thought in the second inning with Gerwitz up, struggling at the plate a little bit, that they possibly could try a squeeze bunt.
This is a deep fly ball. It's not going to carry enough, though, into left center. Krause is there for the second out.
We're starting to see a sinker slider that get balls hit in the air, though. That's not a good sign for Kansas State, because he likes to keep the ball down, gets a lot of ground ball outs. In the first inning, all three outs recorded, even though he gave up a run on ground balls. But when the ball starts to get airborne with a sinker ball, that means the ball's coming up in the zone.
We've seen that with Parker Fringe. When Parker's really good, he's getting ground balls. Tress gets underneath this one. You got to deal with the sun. Yagi does. And a good inning for Corey Fisher. 8-pitch inning. Welcome back. We're tied at one. Beautiful day here in Austin. Don't forget, the 2015 Nike Clyde Littlefield Texas Relays are on Longhorn Network. That's next week. And catch some of the greatest track athletes in the country. They're going to run, they're going to jump, and they're going to throw, all at Mike Myers Stadium. Texas Relays beginning Wednesday at 7 Central on Longhorn Network. Someone who grew up here who's got a dad who is a track nerd. He just loves track and field. It was amazing going out there in the 80s and 90s. I mean, you saw world-class athletes.
In high school and college.
Right. Now we head to the fourth here. It's going to be 4, 5, and 6. Steve Ceratori flied out to Ben Johnson back in the second. Cue ball shot. One pitch, one out. Boswell had a couple errors yesterday, but guys, all in all, for a shortstop who's playing third, I guess I'll focus this to the third baseman over here, Keith. Pretty nice transition.
Well, he's done a nice job. He plays extremely deep. He's got good range. There's going to be, yesterday, one of the errors was not playing there very often and understand what you've got to do when you play in and play back and how to cut a ball off when you go to your left. When you're at shortstop, you're 140 feet from home plate, 135 feet. So it's about ranging and be able to play your hop. At third, you're, you know, 95 feet from the dish. It's a lot different feel.
I'll see right back to Clemens. Pitch it over there and two outs.
That's exactly what Casey needed here in the fourth. He needed a quick frame. He got two quick outs now as a catcher. This Cantu, as a young catcher, go right out there and say, hey, let's go right now. Let's go right after this next guy and end this thing right now.
Strike one.
Strike one. He's exactly right, Greg.
It'll be Alex B. Alex is taking a pitch here. One.
I saw it that time. First time I've noticed exactly what you've been trying to tell us, Greg. Slowed his motion down
right
on that changeup.
Right as he starts towards home plate, it just slows his entire body down and it slows your arm down.
Shaw. He's been taken off the right a little bit more this weekend. He's able to make the play in a 7-pitch inning for Casey Clemens. What a day here in Austin, Texas. Tied at one. Going to the bottom of the fourth inning. Lots of Boy Scouts here. The Girl Scouts. In fact, those Boy Scouts came up to the booth. We were able to say hi to them. It's really a great crowd today, and you get the sense that Austinites kind of been itching to get outside with the overcast weather. Marlowe will lead it off for Texas. Towards right center, ranging over is Brown for the first out.
Well, there's some center fielders we've seen in this league already that can go get it.
Yep.
And Brown can really move and did a nice job right there. Zane Gerwitz can go get it. Last week we have
West Virginia
had one that could go get it. So you're seeing some guys that can really go get it in center field.
Here's Boswell. Brett singled his first time up. Redshirt freshman, Rockwall, Texas. Changing over, making the play is Tyler Moore, or Tyler Wolf, excuse me.
Texas hitters eventually are going to have to break the timing up of Corey Fisher. He's starting to get into a little rhythm right now.
Working quickly. He slows it down when you get runners on against him.
Michael Cantu walked in the second. He's had a good shot in the second as Boswell singled and Cantu walked. Clemens able to sacrifice those guys over, but Gerwitz and Johnson could not get the job done. Outside.
When you can't steal a base, your job as a hitter right here in the middle part of a game in a tie game, you're thinking extra bases. So I was always asked the question, you trying to hit a homer when you hit a homer? No, but there are certain times of the game when you're trying to really drive a ball. You're trying to think gappage to get into scoring position, where there's times you're thinking, well, single to right sounds good right here. And then there's other times where single to right here, if you're Michael Cantu, doesn't really help the club that much.
Right.
I mean, because it's going to take two more hits more likely to score you. But if you drive one into the gap somewhere or down the line, then it's, you're a base hit away from getting on the board.
Sprays that to right. You guys think he's going to really show some power before it's all said and done here?
I think he's going to realize that he has power to right field eventually. I mean, but today during batting practice, he hit one out just left of the scoreboard out there in left center.
with the breeze, the same breeze that there is now.
Outside corner, ring him up. Corey Fisher with a 1-2-3 inning, 9-pitch inning. We'll talk with Augie next. Welcome back. We are tied at one. We head to the top of the fifth inning. Joining us now is the head coach for Texas, Augie Garrido.
Hey, Coach Casey out there laboring, as your starters have done this weekend, but he's doing a great job, just the one run.
He's doing a good job. He has been aggressive inside the strike zone with his fastball and his changeup, just enough to keep him off balance.
Offensively, Coach, you're still trying to put things together. I noticed that you did have Clements bunt. Now, we speculated. Did you do that because he's a pitcher at DH today, or would you have bunted with anybody at the plate there?
Usually I do bunt, but it was because of him being the pitcher and not wanting him to have to run the bases and having confidence in the guys behind him to get the job done.
Coach, finally got some weather to play baseball. Let's do it.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Casey out for his fifth inning of work, and you see what he did against Rice. That was in Houston, and really that first inning just blew up. He's been much better since then.
Just about a 2 ERA. That's tough to overcome when you have a start like that. More so as a reliever if you give up all those runs, but Casey has done a good job, pitched well in Arlington, and has really battled today.
He has. I don't think he's had his best stuff today.
Two breaking balls, though, in a row, and that's something that he was not getting over necessarily, and got both those over.
He got them over, but they're still up.
Oh, they're up.
In the zone. But it's good for him. He's trying to find it. He's trying to get the feel for it.
1-2 to Tyler Moore. Tyler has scored the only run for Kansas State. Single back in the third. Came around on the Dalrymple single.
Well, I would think he's on a pretty short leash. Did pitch on Tuesday, as you mentioned, and they would love to get him through this frame for sure.
Three, two coming up to the number seven man in the order, Tyler Moore. Fifth three ball count for Clemens. Snags that. Helping himself out.
Good reaction and pretty good position to make the play. Is keep your head up when you deliver it.
He really stayed good balance at the end of that delivery. A lot of pitchers will fall off and not be in fielding position. That one, Casey was right on.
There's Max Brown. Max sacrificed back in the third. 6-6. Been fun to watch play center field. Really go get it.
What amazes me is the size, the 6-6, and he's still able to get around that outfield like he does. I mean, you don't see that.
No, you don't.
You see him at first base or that's about it, pitch.
You see a Richie Sexton or something like that?
Yeah.
Richie Sexton was a huge man.
Yeah, he was.
He was bigger than 6'6", wasn't he?
6'10", I think. 6'9"?
Yeah. I think 6'8". He was just huge.
You played with him, didn't you?
In Cleveland? Yeah, when he was young in Cleveland.
When you were young.
I was old.
2-2 coming up to Brown from North Bend, Washington.
Dave Parker was 6'6", 6'5".
He was a
big
tree.
Man. He was a tree. You're right.
3-2. I used to love when Parker would just get a hold of one.
When the leaves turn brown, Dave will be wearing the crown.
He said. He used to talk to the ball when it came by.
Oh, yeah, he did.
I see ya.
He used to talk to the ball?
Oh, yeah.
That's great. 3-2. Barrera saying, hey, Casey, I may not be you, but I'm not bad over here.
I have you.
You're right, I got you.
Good play by Trace. Gets to it. Ball right over the bag down the line. See, Trace has to dive. Ball's in foul territory. Does a great job of getting to his feet. Casey might have been a little late getting over there, but Trace says, I got it. Yeah, Casey kind of hesitated, not thinking or not knowing Trace was going to come up with that ball.
So two outs, and that brings up Tyler Wolf. Guys, you would think if he can get through this, to go along with your thinking, if you want to bring in Travis Duke, you've got three of the next four guys are all lefties, and they're their best hitters.
Oh, I think there's no doubt that this would be a really positive outing for Casey, put himself in good position. If Texas can find a way to scrape one across, put him in line for a victory. And I think this is something to build off of today.
A little letter high Powder River right here. Back downstairs.
Not go around as John Osmus at first.
Well, he found his breaking ball in this inning. He's thrown six different ones in this inning, and he didn't throw any that looked good coming into this frame, and he's done a nice job with his breaking ball in this inning. There's that Powder River.
Yeah.
You have to continue to throw the pitch. You're going to find it, whether it be the slider or the curveball. The changeup, he struggled with a little bit, but he's continued to throw this breaking ball, and he's starting to find a feel for it.
Nice play by a fan. Got the glove out and was able to use it. One ball, two strikes, two outs. We're tied here at one. Texas looking for the series sweep. Kansas State hoping to get their first Big 12 win of the year. Didn't chase it. Counts even.
You can get that runner in.
Got some choices here.
Up and in.
Yep.
But can't be the one that's head high. I mean, right around the letters. Tried to yank that one. Yanking it, meaning overthrew it. Front shoulder flew out. Arm couldn't catch up.
It's going 3-2 a lot. Yeah, you got him there. Kelly Nutt behind the plate's going to ring him up. Played 4.5. We'll talk with Brad Hill when we get back. Welcome back to the Dish. Got a good ball game here, tied at one. Joining us now, head coach Brad Hill.
Hey, Coach. Corey Fisher gave up the one in the first inning. Since then, he's kind of settled down and found his groove.
Done a really good job here. He kept us in the, obviously throwing those zeros up there after the first inning. And like I said, on Sunday, who'd expect a 1-1 ball game so far? But it is what it is. Both pitchers are doing a great job.
Well, I can see, Coach, you're trying to run. You're trying to create some offense. I know you've talked to us about trying to do some different things to find a way to get across the plate.
Well, the big thing is we got to get the hit right now. We just can't seem to get that one hit to kind of put us over the hump. I sure thought Shane was in the right spot last inning, make that happen, and unfortunately didn't get it done. But we'll keep working at it.
Coach, always enjoy talking with you. Good luck this year, all right?
Thank you, guys.
Now, Fisher, since that walk back in the second inning, he's retired 9 in a row.
Yes, he has.
17 strikes and 5 balls.
8-9-1, due up for Texas. Here's Casey Clemons, who sacrificed his first time up. And yes, Keith asked Augie about it. He said, but part of that was because he's a pitcher.
Well, Greg had speculated on that. I just wanted to ask him to see if that was what part of his thinking.
I'm sure Greg thought about that a couple times, right?
Great minds think alike.
Man, I hope they let me bunt here so I can get back to the dugout.
I would bunt just to get back to the dugout.
Well, I'm just the opposite as a hitter. I'm thinking hit one in the gap.
You're right. Well, guys, I'm curious. Casey was so good defensively at first, and he's shown offensively, he's hit the ball pretty well so far. I'm curious that when Texas gets back to it and Casey's not pitching, Do you guys start him at first? I'll start with you, Keith.
Well, what I know is that he can flat play first base. It also allows you to have your catchers to do some learning about their pitchers a little bit.
First base, Conlin will flip it over, and there's one out.
Because you'll see him at first. He's outstanding defensively. He can do a lot of different things. We saw that in the 2014 campaign. And then he has the ability to hit, and he's got 225 collegiate at-bats. So it's not like he's going to be overwhelmed when he goes to the plate. He played through all of last year playing over there. He does a lot of good things at first base defensively. But for me, it allows Cantu and Barrera to get some time off not being on the field, and they can be over with their pitching coach, even though they're DHing, and learning how to call a game and do some other stuff, because I really think it takes a little bit away from Trace and to Michael that the day they're not catching, even though they're in the lineup, they're at first, and their mind's not on how to handle a game. And I think that comes into play for me a little bit.
No, those are great points, but I also think that he's going to have to hit. He's going to have to get hits, drive in runs. I know he doesn't have very many at-bats this year, but at some point, they're going to have to find another hitter.
You're right.
Right? I mean, the DH spot is just hasn't been there. You're up there to hit. And I also think that with him playing first now, that gives you the option late in games. I mean, he's one of the best in the country over there at first base to come in and play first as a defensive replacement late in the game.
Yep.
Let's see if Zane gets that slider. He's had some problems with the slider the last couple weeks. Ate him up last night.
Just like to see him start using the right side of the field. Seems everything right now is pull conscious to me. Pitch right there. Now that was an off-speed pitch that was up, and a lot of times you're going to pull that pitch when it doesn't have a lot on it and it's upstairs, but I like it when he's thinking right field. When he's thinking right field, letting the ball get deeper into the strike zone, he's much more effective as an offensive player.
Seventh pitch of the at-bat is spoiled. Do it again.
I mean, isn't it true that even if you're thinking right field, you're still going to pull the ball occasionally?
Yes. Yeah, because you're going to get there a little quick because of the velocity change.
Was that foul?
Well, when you start trying to pull that ball away as a pitcher, you go instantly, that's a shortstop who's going to play that play. And you're going to roll right over the top of it.
And I'm going to keep throwing them.
Longest at bat of the game, ninth pitch coming up. Upstairs, and Zane will take that. Chance for Texas here with the top of the order coming up, and Ben Johnson, he's due. He's 0 for 2.
First pitch slider. Guess it and go if I'm Zane Gerwitz.
Knowing.
And if I'm Ben Johnson, I'm
thinking right center, and I'm
right.
Letting it go too.
And that's what you're thinking, though, Kansas State's thinking, all right, Ben's such a good first ball, fastball hitter.
Exactly.
Start him with a slider. That gets back to what you guys were talking about earlier. You kind of
feed off his aggressiveness.
Zane's got a big lead. Both feet are on the green part of the turf. Not going. Fastball.
And it was a fastball away.
The exact opposite.
But it wasn't even close.
Right.
Well, you guys aren't saying it's 100%, but you do have to go with odds, and you guys played long enough, you realize more often than not, it'll work out.
Also read that pitch. Get that secondary lead. If it's in the dirt, go.
Got a hanger too, but he was thinking right field. a lot of credit to Fisher. He's battled. He's mixed in some pitches.
Kind of been every pitcher of this series, starting pitcher. One that's come in and really done, hadn't struggled, putting Kirby Bellow out of the bullpen.
Yeah. Even Hollinsworth. Gerwitz takes off to left field. This is going to be in. And Gerwitz coming around third. He's going to score a RBI double for Ben Johnson. Texas retakes the lead.
Smokey in the house.
Well, Greg, you just talked about it. Try to get something going, put some pressure on the defense. Now they put the hit and run. Breaking ball does stay up. Johnson puts a really good swing on it. Ball jumps off of Ben's bat. Gerwitz scores easily with the movement from first base. And Texas finally gets back on the board. It's good offense right there. Great at bat by Gerwitz to get on base, and then a nice job by one of the hottest hitters in the country in Ben Johnson.
A good read by Zane as well. He was past second base when that ball hit the ground and scored easily.
Kicking off with the pitch. Texas is going to try and add on. Here's Colin Shaw. He's due. He's 0 for 2. Foul ball. Well, Texas, the last 12 batters before Ben Johnson, no hits. So Fisher had done a nice job of kind of
silencing
Texas.
Extra base hits. Go back to slugging percentage.
And Zane's at bat. Texas. Fisher had retired 9 in a row.
Yeah, that was the longest at bat of the game, 9 pitches. Zane coaxes a walk. One, two. Colin struggling a little bit in this series, 1 for 10.
You talked about it. If Casey Clemens is done, he kept his team in this game.
Yes,
they scored him a run here. He would be pitcher of record for the win. Texas is able to hold on.
Oh, 2 to right. Going back, going back. This is a no doubter onto Comal Street. A bomb from Colin Shaw.
Oh, wow. That's old school right there.
Kieschnick.
Colin Shaw. 0 home runs coming into his senior season. Gets his second one right here.
Well, he gets a fastball, middle part of the plate in, and it was up. Second ball in the row that got in the air, and this ball is out of here as it gets out onto Kamau. Just like that, boy, what a change. 3 runs in a heartbeat.
Wow.
That's when offense is going well. A walk, a double, and a homer, extra base hits. I'm just slugging percentage.
And if you're Kansas State, guys, how do you feel?
You're deflated right now.
You score that run, you feel like you got momentum back, but you also know how hard it's been to score against Texas pitching. 3 runs, and we know this from covering Texas the previous couple years, 3 runs can seem like 10.
It's very deflating if you're Kansas State.
Extra base hits in the series. Texas has 9. That's the reason they're on the road for a sweep. And only 2 for KSU.
Josh Reynolds, the pitching coach, is going to come out. You see Brandon Erickson getting loose, and I think they're going to go to Brandon. Well, Corey hung in there as long as he could, guys, but got to the 5th here. And Zeke, you mentioned it. It's kind of that Zane Gerwitz 9 pitch at bat. That almost seemed to be the breaking point.
And Keith started talking about it. Although he had retired 9 in a row, the balls were starting to get elevated. That wasn't a bad pitch to Colin Shaw right there, but the double by
Johnson was a breaking ball.
Ben
up.
Johnson. And then the fastball was up just enough for Colin. That's one of the furthest home runs I've seen hit this year.
No doubt. Augie talking with Colin Shaw. We'll give you the numbers on the new Kansas State pitcher. They got a new pitcher because Texas is raking right now. They lead 4-1. All smiles in the Texas dugout. Ben Johnson, RBI double. He came around to score on Colin Shaw's two-run home run to right that ended up in Comal Street. Old school stuff there. Brandon Erickson is your new pitcher. He's from Redding, California. He's a junior, 5'10", 210 pounder. He's making his ninth appearance of the year, 3.46 ERA. You know anything about him?
The numbers right there. There goes Stout Kid on the mound right now. He's going to do about the same type stuff that Fisher had. He's a sinker slider pitcher. Nothing too overpowering.
CJ swinging at the first pitch. Sertori, and that is nice play by Conlin to snag it, but that'll be an E5. And
well, Brad Hill told us yesterday when we had an opportunity to visit with him, he says, we just haven't been good enough defensively. You look at our numbers, it doesn't look that bad. He says, but we just give away routine outs, and this is one of those situations where you just give away a routine out right there. And now you have your pitchers having to throw more pitches and more base runners.
Nice job by Conlin just to snag that and probably saved a base as Tres Pereiro steps to the plate. Tres doubled and brought a run home back in the first. This is crushed to center. Brown going back makes the play. Trace hit it on the nose, but it's a loud out.
Everybody says, is that disappointing to you? I get asked that question a ton of times. As a hitter, if you hit a ball, you know what? It's not disappointing. You know, sometimes you feel like as a hitter, well, am I ever going to get a break? But you keep hitting it like that every time, it's going to find a location.
Well, Tress got one yesterday that down the right field line that he couldn't have tossed better.
Well, hitters never think of it even out. Neither do pitchers. Oh, you got a bunch of dinks off of me, right? Zeke?
I was facing Cincinnati Reds one night, and they hit lasers like that all over the ballpark. And after the game in the paper the next day, Davey Johnson says, I wish I had a dime for every line drive we hit last night right at someone. I sent Davey Johnson a dollar over to the locker room.
What you do? You got a dollar's worth.
He sent it back signed. Giggum.
Where's Davey and Aggie? A little Longhorn Aggie love there. Kevin Dunn, Keith Moreland, and taking off is CJ. He wanted to get an early jump, a little bit too early of a jump. But Texas able to get three on Colin Shaw's second home run. Longhorns lead it by three.
Well, on a day when Casey Clemens is going to take the mound on a Sunday for these Texas Longhorns. Fielded his position well early in the game, helped himself out in many ways while it's coming back to him, but really battled the entire day and kept his team in the game. You see a nice cutter right there, showing emotion, kept the Longhorns tied 1-1. They were able to put up a three spot in the fifth inning, and right now he is the pitcher of record for the win if Texas can hold on. And he was in the game as a pitcher designated hitter, so now he's out as a pitcher. He will remain in as the designated hitter.
Got the sleeve on to keep that arm warm. Obviously can't ice up right now. He'll give way to Travis Duke, the junior from Pearland, Texas. 6'3", 210-pounder. We've not seen Travis as much as I think a lot of us would expect this year. 1.86 earned run average. This will be his ninth appearance. Gave up one earned run as a sophomore.
He gets out. That's what Travis Duke does.
He's got the top of the lineup. This makes sense. Three out of the next four hitters are lefties, and it'll start with Carter Yagi.
Be careful with a pull bunt here.
CJ will backhand it. Throw over, and there's one out.
Just thinking maybe with Travis Duke on the mound, lefty falling off, and a little speedy left-handed hitter might try to pull it with him.
Great thought, because obviously Travis does fall hard to the third base side. Down. One of those guys, Craig, when you look at pitchers, there are certain guys who deliver a baseball
It comes out of their hand, and you just, as a hitter, you have a tough time picking it up. And Travis is obviously one of those guys. He's not dominating in his velocity, but what is important, I think, is the fact is that you can just tell hitters do not pick up the ball coming out of his hands.
Catches Dalrymple. Got the only RBI for Kansas State today.
When he asked Skip Johnson, as long as he's going to come out and argue that the hitter didn't try to get out of the way there.
Kelly Nutt and Augie discussing it.
Sometimes you can pick and choose arguments. Son. Right now, you just put up a three spot. It did nick him. And there's the turn. We talk about the turn.
It's just enough casual turn. Yes, he didn't move it away quickly. He knew he was going to get hit with it. But he just, that last little bit's going to give him first base. If he stays there with the elbow and doesn't make a discernible effort to get out of the way, I think he'll be remain it for at home plate. But instead, he's going to be awarded first base.
Shane Conlon. Conlon had some problems with that sweeping curve that Kirby Bello threw yesterday. A lot of lefties had problems with that.
He's going to see it again. Travis Duke does firm as those guys, but has the same type curveball.
This could be two. Barrera, nice pick by Hinojosa, and then Duke trying to cover couldn't make the play, but they do get the lead out. For a right-handed first baseman, Keith, you played that. Not an easy play here.
It's not an easy play, but he does reverse pivot, and the throw's just down. And Hinojosa knows he has to go. Conlon runs real well. Duke tried to get back there, and that's a tough play for him, trying to find the bag and reaching back. Zeke, I'll refer to you. That is a difficult play on a pitcher. You're trying to find the bag, find the ball, and doing it all at a high rate of speed.
Yeah, and you have to get there quick. I mean, you can't expect to get there at the same time as the ball when it's coming from second base. Very tough position for Travis Duke to be in right now, but fortunately for the Longhorns, the ball stayed in the playing field. Conlon stays at first.
Steve Ceratori.
Duke bending over, stretching. We haven't pitched in a while. It's tough to keep yourself active down there. You can throw in the bullpen occasionally.
He did act like there was
a little tightness in
something.
His lower back.
Back, yeah, it's going to be on the
side. That's going to bring Skip out.
Also, the trainer, Michael West.
You can tell by body language.
Can. Something wasn't right.
Right. And he missed by 4 feet.
Right. See if you guys see anything. Here's the last pitch.
Always does that little leg lift, but that right there tells me something wasn't feeling right. He always does on his delivery to the plate. He always has that little prance, I guess, that little leg kick back up.
With his push-off foot.
Obviously okay enough to stay in this game.
Two and oh count to Ceratori. Steve is 0 for 2, flied out to Ben Johnson in the second, also grounded out to Brett Boswell back in the fourth inning. Only two hits for Kansas State today. Five hits for Texas. As Keith has pointed out, the extra base hits, it's been a problem for the Wildcats, only two this weekend. And they don't have enough Tony Gwynn's to go station to station and hit three singles in an inning.
Texas has not walked a lot of batters and given them a lot of opportunities to have those base runners. And, you know, it's hard to score multiple runs in an inning if without an extra base hit.
Left center Ben Johnson tracking it down. Struck pretty well, but not well enough for Ben Johnson not to get there. Travis Duke with a good inning. Take a look at the Big 12 standings. TCU and Texas both at 4-1. Now TCU is trailing Oklahoma State 4-0. That's in the third inning. Texas Tech is actually trailing Oklahoma. Oklahoma looking to take that series 2 out of 3. And Texas with a win here. Be very important to get that sweep, go to 5-1. But also the fact that West Virginia and Kansas State are not expected to be at the top of the conference. You would think Texas' Big 12 schedule is only going to get tougher.
12 road games left on the Big 12 schedule for Texas. It's hard to win away from home in this conference, and the first two conference series are both at home. So it obviously tells you there's only two more conference series left to play here in Austin. So got to take care of business today. Put yourself at 5-1. Next week's an off weekend where you travel on the road to go to Nebraska, which is a tough place to play. It's good for inter-league play, so to speak.
Right.
But when you get back from that, it's going to be a lot of road series.
Conlin able to stick with it. And Erickson makes the play for the first out. Take a look at their upcoming schedule, and this is what Texas looking at. You got Texas State on Tuesday
at San Marcos.
Yeah, in San Marcos. Go at Nebraska. We'll be back March 31st here on Longhorn Network for Texas A&M Corpus Christi. The U is going to have the Oklahoma State series. That should be a good one. Boswell trying to lay down the bunt, and there are two outs.
Well, that's going to be an interesting series, especially it's 4-0 right now. Oklahoma State in Fort Worth trying to take 2 out of 3 in that series, which is tough to do on the road, and you're going to have to go to Oklahoma State. So again, taking care of business at home, and you get the opportunity, as Coach Garrido talks about, if you do get the opportunity to sweep a series, those mathematical numbers are gigantic. I mean, it's you always want to win one on the road. You want to win series. And then if you get the opportunity, you want to get those sweeps when you get the chance.
Yeah, this, if Texas holds on and sweep Kansas State right now, it gives you kind of the, I wouldn't call it the luxury, but losing 2 out of 3 on the road wouldn't hurt as much.
Yes.
Because you do get those sweeps. I mean, sweeps, you can start to separate yourself from tier to tier in this conference. And if you do have a tough loss on the road, it doesn't hurt as much because you're playing well at home.
That was a pass can too, 1-2.
Yeah, well, it'd be a month before you and I'll be sitting here talking about RPIs. So because that's the next for. Obviously, you want to win the conference, and then you start setting yourself up for the postseason.
Nice pitch, took something off, and a good inning for Brandon Erickson. 1, 2, 3. We're through 6. Tonight's or today's game summary, it's powered by the new Chevy Silverado. We take a look at what Casey Clemons was able to do. Maybe not his best stuff, but was able to battle through it. Only one earned run, is in line for the win, did retire the last 7 batters. As for Texas, Colin Shaw, 2-run homer in the 6th. That brought home Ben Johnson, who had doubled home a run to take the lead, and that's kind of where we stand. Been a pretty good baseball game, guys.
It's been a good series. I mean, a close series. Seems like Texas has been in control, but the games have been close. Texas having to come back a couple games, but this game today, Casey battled early.
Danny Krause to Hinojosa. Nice play by CJ. Trace stays on the bag for the first out.
Casey battled in this game early, but settled down with the last seven hitters retired. He went to the breaking ball, found it later in the game, and put himself in line for a W.
I think the other part that we've felt like, too, in this situation is Texas offensively just hasn't had the opportunity to separate themselves. And I'm going to give credit to the KSU pitching staff. They've done a nice job. They haven't been overpowering, but they've kept the ball down. They haven't given a lot of walks to Texas. And they've gotten outs when they needed to, when Texas had a chance to really blow games open.
Dominic Thornton's going to come in to pinch hit. He's a freshman from Houston. Looks like Travis Duke's day is done. Good effort, right, Greg?
He gets outs. That's what Travis Duke does. Comes in and pitches well, and that's what you want to do. In the middle of a game, in the middle of a close game, your team just took the lead. Travis Duke came in, gave him over an inning, kept him in check. Texas fans are going to like it.
Connor Mays will be the new pitcher. Hey, don't forget, the Texas softball team hosts UTSA in a Tuesday doubleheader. It's now a doubleheader beginning at 5 p.m. Central. So if you're not aware of that, we're going to play two, Lindsey Stevens and crew. Game two will begin at 7:30 p.m. Central. Both games will be seen right here on Longhorn Network. And don't forget, you can also check out the very cool app, which is Watch ESPN. I am addicted to that app. Kevin Dunn, Greg Swindell, Keith Moreland, Texas with a 4-1 lead. We're here in the top of the seventh. There's one out and nobody on. And Connor Mays, the freshman from Lake Travis, is going to be on the hill now. Well, we welcome you inside the booth. And, well, guys, we finally got nice weather for a baseball game. But you got the sense that I got the sense from you two guys that Texas needed a sweep this weekend. And they needed to show that it's not just potential and talent. Have you liked what you've seen so far?
Well, I have. We just got through talking about the fact they really haven't separated themselves and gotten a big hit when they needed to blow a game open. But when you look at the numbers and what Texas has to do in this conference, with the first two conference series, if they win today, they sweep this series, they go 5-1, but they still have 12 games to play on the road in this conference. It's tough to win in the Big 12 on the road. So they've really done a pretty good job of coming away with a 5-1 if the game holds on as they're at right now, and come away 5-1. They put themselves in a pretty good position.
Yeah, I mean, and they have to go to Fort Worth. They have to go to Stillwater. I mean, not easy place. Not any place is easy to win, but those teams are battling out this weekend. Oklahoma State's playing well. TCU, number one in the country.
Yeah.
So not tough places, easy places to go play.
Don't be down, even though Riley Farrell gave up a home run. Don't be down against TCU because they can pitch. Here's Connor Mays. First pitch strike to fellow freshman Texas, Dominic Thornton. Dominic went to Cy Falls.
Greg, what we saw last Sunday from Connor Mays is his ability to use all of his pitches. That's the first time I've seen him being able to come in, not only command his fastball, but he had an outstanding breaking ball that he was able to throw for a strike in almost any count.
Yeah, he came in. It's funny. It was Big 12. I mean, it was conference time, and Connor Mays did come in. He stepped it up a notch in that game. Skip Johnson knew that was in him. And like you said, when you can start to throw the breaking ball anytime and get ahead of hitters, he really picked this team up last weekend. I mean, they thrived off of what he took to the mound and the emotion that he showed inning by inning.
And saw him grow up.
Just saw him grow up, and another weapon. Yesterday, lesson learned, came in, gave up an 0-2 hit, was taken out of the game.
And that one slips.
Where's that,
there's
Dom?
No intent there. It's the second Wildcat to be hit by a pitch in the last couple innings. So one out base runner. Bring up the catcher, Tyler Moore. Mays' pitching coach was a Longhorn legend and a guy you played with, Dennis Cook. Did Cookie pitch in the bigs as long as you did?
Oh, yeah. Cookie was, I think, 14 years, maybe?
Oh, yeah.
And a few pinch hit homers.
I mean, he did a lot of different things. He's got a few rings, too, doesn't he?
A couple rings. Got one with Florida. Got one with Anaheim. Didn't pitch. Was injured a little bit.
And Hossa only plays at first. And hey, what, CJ has really had a nice weekend, not only at the plate, but also defensively.
He's made a lot of good plays going to his left, but he does a nice job here to his right, understanding. He said, look, I've got to get an out. So he sets his feet, comes across his body. Perfect throw to get the out at first. And you could try to go to second, but at this point of the game, when you got a three-run lead, get an out.
You get to the seventh, eighth, and ninth inning. You just start, you count outs from that point on.
Two outs for Max Brown. We mentioned Cookie. Cookie hit 364 in 85.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, he could hit.
Played right field, didn't he?
Yeah, he played right.
Played right field most of the time. Remember him against UTA pitching. Allowed two hits and picked them both off of first base when they were getting their secondary lead.
Thought that was Steve Cantu's job. One and one. You had a couple guys. Rusty Richards played first and would come in and pitch.
Rusty, Cookie,
Zeke. That's fastball. That's where you want to put it, Greg.
He's shown he has a good angle on the ball. That ball down the zone. Can't do too much with that when it's down like that, that location.
Texas is 10-0 when leading after six innings, and you got to feel pretty good right now. Kansas State 0-9 when trailing after six.
See the young pitcher right now. Gave up the hit yesterday on the breaking ball. Hit the guy today on the breaking ball. He's a little timid with it.
Good point.
He goes back to it. Counts full.
Doesn't always have to be a great pitch. It just, it has to be down.
Right.
But it doesn't have to be, it doesn't have to be on the black away, breaking away.
Thornton at second. Brown stays alive.
Get some good run on that fastball.
About to say, that does look like it's moving.
Yeah, when the ball isn't as, I mean, that wasn't too low, I mean, right below the knees, and he fouls it off feet. That means it's got some late movement.
Connor tossed a perfect game with 10 Ks against Del Valle his junior year. He was 11-0 with a 0.69 ERA with 90 Ks as a senior. His third team All-State. Blows it by him, 91. He had 10 strikeouts the other night. He adds one here. Time to stretch him. Great atmosphere here in Austin, Texas. Longhorn fans got the brooms out, looking for a little sweep. And of course, there's the Peanuts, Cracker Jacks, and all sorts of things out here at the ballpark. After the rainy day yesterday where Texas swept the doubleheader, not much atmosphere out here. You can understand why. And Longhorn fans definitely enjoying a Sunday here. Why not? Perfect weather, 73 degrees on the big board. A little bit of cloud cover.
Not on the dish.
Not on the dish is right. And Casey Clemens, a designated hitter, started this game pitching and as the DH, will step up. 8-9-1 due up. Brandon Erickson had a nice seven pitch inning last time out. He's just trying to keep the Cats in it and hoping they can get something going offensively. It's not been a good weekend for a Wildcat program that is known in college baseball. They're going to be good. They're usually pretty offensive.
Yeah, you're right. And they've gotten some base hits. But they haven't been able to drive the ball. No extra bases, just two in this entire series.
And Keith, you go back to Kansas State even 8-10 years ago, they had some, a lot of Texans, they had some kids that could really drive the baseball.
Yeah, and obviously the change in the ball and the bat, but you know, notice how we're not talking about that. We're seeing the ball travel much more. The pendulum's coming back. There's no question about that.
Ooh. Misses there. Four pitch.
Four straight.
Walk, and Clemens will take first. This could be a time that you pinch run here. We'll see if Texas will do that, considering that is the DH. Like Casey will stay in there for Zane Gerwitz.
He's not pitching anymore. He can run all the bases he wants.
Right. But I was thinking maybe get Mathis, maybe someone a little faster in there.
A little faster.
Sophomore from San Antonio, not off to the start he wanted his sophomore season. Keith's talked about some of the mechanical things.
I'd like to see him still think about using right field a little more. As a freshman last year, awful lot of big hits going the other way.
Yeah, he was filling up right center. He's going to get the bunt down here and gets the job done. Texas looking for some insurance, and Clemens is in scoring position with one out.
Zane does a good job. Had two sacrifice bunts yesterday, one today. Getting the bunt down.
Well, you're going to, if you get that opportunity, you got one of the hottest hitters in the country, and Ben Johnson, as he steps to the plate here, it's been a while since Ben has gone a game without hitting at least three balls right on the button.
Game two last night, he was 2 for 4. That could have easily been 4 for 4. Everything was stung.
He's almost one of those guys that when you pitch against him, you just, please don't hit it back up the middle because the ball jumps off his bat.
There's a different sound, too. I know you guys have talked about that at the big league level. You knew when Bonds or whoever was hitting, you could just hear the bat.
Well, strength and conditioning coaches don't pull many punches. They're pretty honest guys. So he might be this pound for pound one of the strongest guys on campus.
That's
in the
sport.
Athletic program. Tells you his strength.
Strongest guy on the baseball team, fastest guy. He's about a 6'4", 60 guy. As we've talked about, he had numerous rides, I believe Texas State included, to play quarterback. So, I mean, D1 rides. Probably could have punted in college. Grandfather ran track at Notre Dame. Go through his family, and you see where the genes come from. I think everyone played D1 something.
Darren Erst did, punted in college, and made a pretty good baseball career.
Yeah. Yes, he did.
He was an All-American punter at Nebraska.
Texas will see him next week as he's the head baseball coach at the University of Nebraska.
Yes, he is. His brother Will played baseball at Vanderbilt. Dad played football at Maine.
Now, Zeke, you're going to reach out here and make this catch. If it comes up here, you're not going to deke me, though, right?
Oh, no.
Not going to put your hand out there and then all of a sudden go, I don't think I'm going to try that.
I got my two All-Americans. You guys got my back, right?
Well, I'm good with it as long as, you know, those guys that reach out and go, I'm going to take it, and then they see how hard it's coming and say, no, they're not.
If it comes back harder, I'll jump in front of it for
okay,
you.
Okay, good.
I can't eat with these hands, so it's up to you guys. To left. This is going to be another RBI for Ben Johnson. Coming home is Clemens, and Johnson to second, safe. Second double in a row for Ben Johnson, and another ribby.
Well, most would think this would be a single. Ben Johnson puts it out there just enough in the left field. And he knows where it's going to land. Good read by Casey Clemens as well. And Ben Johnson just, there's no one that hustles more. I mean, that was out of the box. He started running as soon as he hit the ball. Watch this. Ball jammed him. He knows it right there. It's going to drop. It'll be a tough play. Now he puts the burners on. Just beats the throw.
Kansas State's going to go to a pitching change. 10th extra base hit for Texas this series compared to the Wildcats, too.
And that was hustle. Great explanation there, Zeke, because that's exactly right. You get extra bases on that play by leaving home plate and what you do when you leave home plate.
Mitch Plassmeyer will be the new pitcher. We'll be back. Texas leads.
The junior from Westlake, actually Westwood here in Austin, Texas, Ben Johnson, has had a fantastic weekend. Started when he threw out a runner at the plate in game one of yesterday's doubleheader. Comes back in game two, and offensively, he is dynamite. Doubles into left center to drive in the first run of the game, and then triples to drive in the second run. And two more times yesterday lined out in a 2-for-4 performance. And then today, he gets Texas on the board with a double to drive in Zane Gerwitz early in the game. And then this hustling double, his second RBI, his second extra base hit, and his 15th multiple hit game of the year. That's impressive, as he's got to be one of the nation's leaders in hits. He's got approaching 50 halfway through the season.
He's thinking about first team All-American and obviously maybe first rounder. If you take a look at Mitch Plassmeyer, 6'3", 190-pound freshman from St. Louis. A couple righties due after Colin Shaw. Maybe one batter here?
3 2/3 innings and 6 appearances. So, yeah, he's a situational lefty. Comes in just to try to get these lefties out. You see the delivery there is just a straight sidearm, almost underhand. Breaking ball will obviously go away from a left-handed hitter.
Colin Shaw 1-for-3, a two-run homer his last time up in the fifth inning that went all the way to Comal Street. That brought back memories for all of us. This is lifted to left. Heading back is Krause. And there are two outs here.
Before the six hits, we talk about it all the time and what slugging percentage does for you as a team and OPS as a team. Four of the six Texas hits are extra bases, three doubles and a homer. And of the runs scored, the double by Barrera leads to the first run. The double and homer leads to the three runs in the third, and a double leads to the run. So every run produced in today's game, an extra base hit.
Gonna have a new pitcher. Good call there, Zeke. Lucas Beninati. Beninati will get you his numbers here in a second. Well, one of the storylines this weekend has been the Texas defense. At times had a couple issues, but all in all, guys, they've been very smooth, including the guy who's up at the plate now, C.J. Hinojosa. We've seen him do a lot of different things in the field.
Yeah, I mean, his range, for one, his first step, you see here going straight up the middle. He gets ready to throw the ball as he fields it. He's been doing a good job, I mean, since his freshman year, the quickness and the first step. Like I said, he's over there in Brooks Marlowe territory catching that ball. And here he ranges to his right, sets his foot. Making better throws, and see right here, he understands the speed of the runners, does not try to rush that one right there. C.J. Hinojosa has come a long way since he's been on campus. He's worked hard.
He's worked at it, and there's no question about it. He always had the arm strength. He made three miscues early in the year, or Texas did in this game, and really C.J. struggled a little bit early in that first series down in Houston defensively, but since then has been outstanding.
No errors for Texas in the last two games. After committing three in game one, Texas is still able to get that win. Marlowe looks on. Here is Lucas Beninati, 6'2", 205-pounder. He's from Santa Barbara. He's a junior. You know anything about old Lucas here, Greg?
Good numbers.
Yeah, he does have good numbers.
Seven appearances and a 1-1. right there. Three pitch pitcher, fastball, slider, changeup. Reach it up there around 90 miles an hour. Because they've been hiding him this weekend. Those are pretty good numbers.
Those are pretty good numbers. Well, actually, what we've seen, Kansas State, and Brad Hill told us that, he says, we're probably a little better. We're more talented on the mound than we were in 2014. Does that mean long term, what does that turn out to be? I can't tell you yet.
Right.
But I said, we have more talent as far as just arm strength and the ability to, you know, for velo and everything else. I think there's a lot of things that happen, and this team's, it's going to get better. I don't think there's question. Most teams in cold weather climates are much better in from mid-April on than they are till the 1st or at least the 15th of April.
And one guy I recognize, Levi Mavoris, who's not been active this weekend, a junior right-hander for them. Levi was one of their starters as a freshman on the 2013 regional team. If he can get going, they do feel like they have some arms. They're going to need him. The Big 12 is loaded. At Oklahoma State, we saw West Virginia. That's a gritty ball club. TCU, those are some arms. And then Texas Tech, not really sure who this Tech team is, but we know that Tim Tadlock's going to have them playing well, and it's never easy to go to Waco to take on Steve Smith and that club. They seem to be kind of all over the place a little bit.
Well, they've taken care of business this weekend. Coming in today, they have won the series against West Virginia with game three today,
which was huge for them. We'll see C.J. Hinojosa here with two outs. Ben Johnson at second. C.J. 1-for-3. Singled and scored back in the first inning to get Texas on the board. Guys, you go back to that first inning. Two quick outs, two quick ground outs for Fisher. And then C.J. with the single, Barrera with the double. Texas was off. Center field, Brown runs pretty well, and he's back there to make the play. Texas is done here in the seventh. We're through seven, Longhorns by four.
National champion.
Welcome back to Austin, Texas. They call it the 40 acres. A lot of the action has been downtown, though, with South by Southwest, the interactive, then music festival, and that ends today. No more hipster apocalypse. We still have plenty of hipsters in Austin, so don't worry.
It'll still be weird.
It'll still be weird. You still
less
get your
hipster.
Less hipsters. Still the
rodeo's in
skinny tight
too,
jeans.
I believe, doesn't it?
Yeah, believe it does.
Went from hipster to redneck.
Pinch hitter is Taylor Anderson swinging at the first pitch, and one pitch, one out for Connor Mays.
Texas pitching on the weekend has been outstanding. The starters, 18 and a third innings, only three earned runs. The bullpen, now seven innings, zero earned runs. A total of 25 innings and a 1.08 ERA for the weekend.
Carter Yagi, the senior from Salt Lake City, looking for his first hit, did walk back in the first. Prototypical leadoff guy. He'll take a lot of pitches, kind of a slasher. And down on the count, 0-2.
Well, you go back to that, and then after a four-game stretch against West Virginia where the and UTA, where the bullpen did not pitch well, it's good to see them respond and come back and have a great weekend by the Texas bullpen.
It still seems like we've talked about it. It seems like every time we try to talk about roles, you know, even yesterday with the win, three guys having to close it out, Ty Colbreth in relief. But that still seems to be up in the air.
Well, and, no, the roles are definitely up in the air. We still,
we don't know,
have no clue who's going to be getting up in the bullpen. Win.
This is hit well. Backhanded by Marlowe from his knees. What a play by Brooks Marlowe.
Well, I would say that's a SportsCenter top 10.
I'm with you.
Outstanding play to his right. Lays his body out. Knows he has to get up right here. Gets to his knees. Makes a strong throw just in time. Yagi runs well, too, to get down the line. Outstanding play right there.
He knew who was running. And you guys talk about that all the time. He knew he had to stay on his knees. And We've seen some Texas guys, Brooks Marlowe and Michael Cantu, make some pretty nice throws from their knees. Two outs for Clayton Dalrymple.
Since the first game yesterday, the three errors, we talked about it in the opening of the second game, that Texas needed to clean it up, clean the defense up, and no errors since, and they've been playing some outstanding defense.
The last hit for Kansas State came back in the third inning. They got a couple singles, and the last guy to get that hit is at the plate right now. The only RBI for the Wildcats. Gets the call.
That's a real good pitch. 2-0, but that ball had some run on it, and a little giddy up on it.
Counts even.
92 on that one.
Again, we don't know. We've been talking about what roles people fill, but I will say this. Connor Mace is going to get the baseball in some capacity.
I'm going to ask you guys right now. I mean, at what point do you move him into a weekend or Tuesday starter role? Close. Greg, you got an answer on that one?
I think that Casey threw well enough today, and I really think that's it. It was more of a who's going to be ready. I know they love Casey's emotion, the way he is when he's on the field. Plays with a lot of emotion. Team feeds off of it. They're going to feed off this young man, too. We'll get back to it.
92 and blows it by Dalrymple. Connor Mays is growing up in front of our eyes. This guy's already grown up. He's been doing this for 4 years. Longhorns three outs away from completing a sweep. Be the first Big 12 sweep in almost a year. The pitching staff has been excellent. They have shut down the Kansas State offense. Those two stats go hand in hand. You can go chicken or egg on that one. But Ben Johnson has been lights out. Four extra base hits. Could have a lot more. He is blast to the ball almost every time he's been up. Trace Barrero will lead it off for Texas here in the bottom of the eighth. Four-run lead, so Kansas State only has three home runs on the year. You're not expecting that, but if you could get one, one swing cannot tie it.
Well, you're going to be on the road on Tuesday down at Texas State to take on the Bobcats, and then on the road next weekend at Nebraska. So you just look, the next four are going to be away from Dish Falk Field.
This is hit to left, and this will fall. Herrera with his second hit. Has a double and now a single. And Trace with a two-hit day.
So it relieves you a little bit. Obviously, they're going to be road games. You're going to be working on some things in road games, as we'll probably have a pitching change here. For me, it is the fact is that you started at this point of taking care of business. What you needed to do for these first two conference weekends, you would love to think that if you can take care of your business at home and win series on the road, you're going to win this league. And that's usually the case.
I'll give the numbers on the new Kansas State pitcher when we get back. Kevin Dunn, Keith Moreland, and Greg Swindell here at UFCU Dish Falk Field. Jackson Douglas will be the new pitcher for Kansas State. Jackson making his eighth appearance. Let's see, 10 innings. He's a big old boy.
Big old boy, 6'6". Tough to hit.
6'6" freshman from Minnesota. Texas had a 6'6" freshman from Minnesota. Ryan Chose.
KJOS.
Yeah. I know one of the problems he had was repeating his mechanics, and it seemed like when one thing went off, it went off pretty bad.
Took Randy Johnson a while to figure it out.
But when he did, it was
right.
Tom House helped him out with that, didn't he?
Yeah.
to the senior from Giddings.
I faced him when he was a Montreal Expo.
Did you? They had Facero. They had Johnson. They had some pretty good pitchers back then. Pedro.
El Presidente.
Mm. The left field. And base hit for Brooks Marlowe. This has been a good weekend for Brooks.
That's a great adjustment that he's made really and truly over the last year and a half to really make the adjustment against left-handed pitching to stay in there, not think pull, and go the other way. That's just a really nice piece of hitting right there. It's something you learn to get that feel early in his career. He struggled with that, came off with a lot of breaking balls. Extended his hitting streak to 11 games. He's really had a great start to his senior year in conference play.
He really has. Hit streak continues. All nine Texas players, batters, have reached.
Kansas State expecting bunt.
I don't think they're going to see a bunt. This is where Texas can maybe play with some people this year, guys, because of the reputation of Augie and the reputation of Texas small ball. And we've seen it in front of our own eyes. You don't know when they're bunting this year. I also know he really likes Brett Boswell.
Ooh, ooh.
Back up the middle. Ferreira's going to be sent home. It is 6-1, Texas. That was laced.
Back-to-back lefties. Staying in on the big left-hander. You see Boswell right here. Again, not trying to do too much. Just takes that fastball on the outer half, right back up the middle. Watch out. Nice job by Brett Boswell and Brooks Marlowe hanging in there on the getting base hits off a tough lefty who has been tough to hit this year.
Boswell 4-for-8 in the series. Texas now 6-for-12 with runners on today.
Arm slot from this big 6'6 left-hander, you would think it would make it more difficult to stay in there because his arm slot's out here about three-quarter.
By the time he lets it go, probably about 54 feet from you.
Cantu looking for his first hit, did reach with a walk in the second. Just struck out a couple times since then. Keith, you've talked about it. He's really been clutch and seems to step up when runners are on and when the moments are big. May not be a huge moment with a 5-run lead, but chance to add on.
Well, those are those type of hitters who are better in run-producing situations than they are with nobody on.
Short, 6-4-3. Cantu bounds into a double play, two outs, and Marlowe is at third.
Well, you can't hit a baseball much harder than that. He just hit it right at the shortstop. And to take that a step farther, Greg, I know you're the same way. You've seen those guys that are just, you know, starting pitchers, the ones that I really like. They just cruise along there. They give up a run. They give up a base runner. They get a couple of guys on, and all of a sudden, they're a foot faster. I mean, those guys that are good, you know, the other way, too. Just like hitters are really good runners in run-producing situations, I've seen pitchers, they just get a lot better when the game's on the line.
Lefty-lefty Clemens here. Marlowe and Boswell did a nice job of staying in on Douglas.
Casey's father was one of those.
Yes.
Is that what they always say, reaching back? You're able to reach back, and maybe if you need one pitch, you're usually 94, you can throw it 96?
Reaching back, but it's just in you. Yeah, you know?
Yeah. Well, no, I don't, but yeah.
You're not trying to throw harder. You're concentrating more, and you're executing pitches. A
Casey Clemons started this game and is in line to get the win. It's a sacrifice. Grounded to first and also walked and scored back in the seventh inning. Good pitch, and he got him to chase it. Nice job by Douglas to come in and get out of a jam. One for Texas, last shot for the Wildcats.
Texas defense today has been outstanding. You see Michael Cantu right here, alertly sees the runner breaking to third. Off balance, perfect throw to Boswell, and here drops a knee. Perfect throw to second base. CJ Hinojosa comes in to his right, recognizes the speed or lack thereof of the runner, no panic. Makes a good throw to first base, and right here, Rooks Marlow, he's done it a lot here at the University of Texas. From his knees as well, throws the runner out. The reigning Gold Glove champion in the second base in college baseball. The defense, that double play combination right there is just, it's a pitcher's best friend. I mean, the double play is a pitcher's best friend, but when you know the guys behind you are going to make plays like that, it gives you more confidence just to get that ball over the plate and let them do it.
Connor Mays out for another inning of work. Yeah, the defense has been stellar, and really the Texas defense has been good this year. There have just been kind of maybe mental lapses at times. We've seen that on the base paths as well, but you're going to make some errors, but the talent and potential is there for this to be an excellent defense and to field 983, 984 around there.
Well, I think you have three things that go into that. One, you're getting to the part of the season now that you're in conference play, so that's the defense is going to step up. Everything should be further along. You're starting to get into a routine, you know, with the off day on Monday as this ball's fly to center. You get the off day on Monday, you play Tuesday, you work out Wednesday. If you're at home, you work out Thursday. If you're on the road, you may travel and work out it on the road on Thursday, and then you play Friday, Saturday, Sunday. So it's getting more into a routine. The weather's going to get better, hopefully.
Yeah.
Even though it wasn't that great yesterday.
I think this Texas team will play a lot better once the weather warms up. Traditionally, they do. Ethan Klosbor. He's a freshman from Humble. Kansas State's done a nice job recruiting everywhere, and they certainly will come into Texas. A couple freshman Texans matching up here.
There's some stats that'll make you think that Connor Mays might deserve a shot in that rotation in March.
What do you got?
He's allowed no runs in 5 appearances, 12 innings, 1 walk, and 14 strikeouts.
That'll do.
Pretty good numbers.
Those sound like your numbers.
And what I've seen out of Connor, I mean, yesterday he could have just ducked his head today. I mean, he came in there for 4 pitches yesterday, gave up a hit on an 0-2 pitch up the middle, was taken out of a ball game. You can see Skip Johnson's eyes. I mean, when Skip goes out there and his eyes are wide open, he's not happy. But he's given confidence in these kids to go back out there. Connor Mays today has proven he can bounce back, come back today, and have better stuff. His breaking ball's been good. His fastball's been exceptional.
Even when he's missing just below the zone right there with a little bit of run.
He looks confident.
He does. Skies this to left. Ben Johnson ranging over, and Kansas State is down to their last out.
You said earlier, mound presence. It's not only just that, it's body language. You can just see he looks confident.
Yeah, when you're going up there as a hitter and you see a very confident kid that has good stuff, gives the pitcher the upper hand. Even if you don't have your best stuff, you go out there, and as long as you show mound presence and show confidence, you're going to get hit around sometimes.
Last chance is
going to get me out.
Sam Chaddick.
No matter what I do. That's what a hitter says, because Hey, 7 out of 10 times, even when you're really good, they do get you out.
Yeah. Hey, look at this guy.
Yeah, he thinks he's going to get me out.
On to their last strike. Right on their feet. Boswell, the throw over. Texas wins it 6-1. Get the brooms out. They sweep Kansas State.
Texas did what they had to do this weekend. They battled the two games yesterday, stayed in them, ended up winning both the games yesterday. Came in today. They were battling until the fifth inning. They dropped a 3-spot and one in the seventh, one in the eighth. Took control of the game, took control of the series. First sweep over Kansas State since 2011. I mean, that's very big for the Longhorns to do it at home against a Kansas State team. Start to maybe see a little separation.
You see some separation. And for me, the separation from this team at this point in 2015 from the 2014 team is the ability for extra base hits. The slugging percentage is better. You see this team has the ability to score runs in bunches.
And when they play teams that don't, this game was over with in the fifth, guys. When they got a 3-spot, you could feel it. 4-1 felt like for Kansas State. And like we said, Texas has been there before. That felt like 10-1.
And Texas pitching on the weekend, I mean, they battled. The starting pitchers battled while they were in there. But overall, I mean, I think you talk about extra base hits. It was a team effort. The defense cleaned it up. The pitching staff for a whole did exceptional on the weekend. The starters 18 1/3 and 3 earned runs. The bullpen 7 2/3, 0 earned runs. Hit a 1 ERA on the weekend. You're going to win a lot of games doing that.
Well, absolutely. There's no question about that. And they took advantage of that. Now, we got to sort of look forward again right here before we get to the eyes. It's going to be a while before we're back here. Got to take care of business on the road over the next couple of weekends.
Yeah, Texas State on Tuesday, then we'll be at Nebraska next weekend. Time for the eyes. Longhorns get the sweep. Once again, our final, Texas 6, Kansas State 1. Tune into LHN on March 31st at 6 Central for Texas Tuesday as the Horns host Texas A&M Corpus Christi. Coming up next, get your stomachs ready. It's home plate with Augie Garrido. For Keith Moreland, Greg Swindell, and our entire crew that did an awesome job, including Brad Sheldon, Drew Irvin, and Brian Gramling, our stat man, I'm Kevin Dunn saying so long from the dish.